Good morning. Okay, friends, let us calm our spirits. Anything that you brought in with you that is stirring in your heart, just let that sit and take these 53 minutes of worship that we might just calm ourselves and receive the Spirit of God for the week that we have ahead. Let us join together in our opening prayer. Let me invite Dakota to come forward to lead us, and let me invite you to stand in body or spirit as you are called.
Good morning. It is good to be with you today. Would you join me in the opening prayer? God, who fills our hunger, fill us today. We gather for moments to focus on you and receive your word. Let our time be hearty and rich and stick to our bones. We give thanks and praise for your grace. Amen.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to lay my high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name.
We are in our last week walking through the meals of Luke. We started a few weeks back looking at the Gospel of Luke through the lens of Jesus going and having meals with everybody, who he had meals with, and what that means, what we might learn by that as people of faith. Last week was the first post-resurrection moment meal. We touched base on the walk to Emmaus. This week follows along kind of in the same category. It's a second post-resurrection story. Both of these events happen the same day that the disciples learn that Jesus has been resurrected. Crucifixion 3 days ago, resurrection is where we are. So have that in your heart as you hear the scripture. The folks on the walk to Emmaus, you will recall last week, did not recognize Jesus as they're walking. He's talking and he's teaching them, and they're saying, did you hear about the crucifixion and resurrection or the crucifixion? And they're confused. And at some point, Jesus ambles on a little bit ahead of them, and they say, hey, come have a meal. Come stay with us. It's getting dark. And Jesus goes, has a meal at their house. And with the breaking of the bread, they realize this was Jesus. And in that moment of revelation and realization, he popped out of the moment. It's sort of like he popped away. So this moment that you hear this week follows on those heels. After Jesus vanished with the breaking of the bread, those disciples that were gathered that heard him on the walk to Emmaus said, the Lord has risen indeed. If you've ever wondered where do we get our expression, Christ is risen indeed, it comes from this moment as those disciples declare it to be true. And then they went, the ones that were with him in Emmaus, they went and told a whole bunch of other people, and they went back to Jerusalem. So what happens here is Jesus goes back, pops into Jerusalem, okay? So that is the story, the message, the teaching that we'll hear this morning. This meal, this moment, as Jesus pops back into Jerusalem, of course he pops back into his fisherman friends, and he gets a meal, a little fishy meal. Okay, that's enough orientation to what you're about to hear. Let me invite John Giard to come up and share with you our scripture lesson today. It is the end of the Gospel of Luke. Come on up.
Good morning, all. I am going to apologize. I'm a little hoarse. I may have been at the game last night. The scriptures for today is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, verses 36 through 43, from the New Revised Standard Version of the Bible. Luke 24, 36 to 43. While they were talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified, and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened, and why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet, and see that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Oh, goodness. Jesus and the credibility issue that we walk with all the way through his lifetime. Who is he? What does it mean? What does it mean about us and how we live our lives? How do we have faith in this God who comes to us in Jesus? The Lord's Prayer includes, as you well know, the phrase, "Give us this day our daily bread." We could do worse than waking and sleeping and reciting that as prayer before God. Give us this day our daily bread. It's a powerful statement of basic human need that God so greatly cares for us that Jesus teaches us to pray for bread, for daily bread. It's not a statement that Jesus gives us that says something like, you know, if it's acceptable in your sight, God, maybe give us bread, or if I'm a good enough and faithful enough servant, give us bread. There's no hedging with this prayer that we receive. Give us daily bread, God. It's a direct statement, direct to God, who is our holy, eternal parent, our parent in heaven. Give us this daily bread. Also interesting about this expression of food that we pray for, it's not a singular statement. Give me my daily bread, God. It's not about just me when we pray for daily bread. It is about give us our daily bread. The nature of our faith, our relationship with God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit, it is bound up in a human experience that is so fleshy and so lived in our body that Jesus gives us this prayer of praying for daily bread, this holy food to fill us up. And over again, as we're struggling in faith, we see it with the disciples in the Gospel of Luke, we feel, know, and can claim our faith with this food that comes into our body. Tactile, lived experience, not separate from the flesh, but wholly integrated, is how Jesus and God come to us. And as we've been walking through the Gospel of Luke, we feel that, we know it. So this walk through Luke's Gospel from the first meal, in Luke 5 at Levi's house, Jesus is with tax collectors and sinners. It sets the stage for us to explore, when we began there, who Jesus is eating with, the nature of these shared meals, this shared living space. But it's also, with that moment, with that meal and all the rest, It is also a means of us understanding what's coming in the future, not just for now, not just for this daily bread, but out into the future in our lived experience. Now, if you wanted to, one Bible study option for you, one moment of personal Bible study reflection that you might want to do, try this. Sit down with your Bible after the Padres win the World Series. Sit down with your Bible and the Gospel of Luke and read through it in one sitting. Just, it's 24 chapters, so it'll take you a little time, but read through it with one sitting and read it for one thing. And if you want, make note of the things that you find that I'm going to tell you, or just highlight it in your own personal Bible, whatever seems right for you. Write down and make note, the Gospel of Luke, all the food references. If you do this, you will notice your heart will be strangely warm and move to how many food references there are in the Gospel of Luke. Almost on every single page of the Gospel of Luke, you get food references. Most people who know the Bible read the Gospels together. In other words, we read one piece and we harmonize it with something from the Gospel of John or the Gospel of Mark. We kind of put the whole thing together. But resist that. Resist sticking your faith story in a blender for just a moment and sit down with just the Gospel of Luke, and you will notice the particular prominence of this theme in Luke's Gospel and how distinctively Luke talks about it differently than the other Gospels. The other Gospels, to be sure, there's plenty of food in them too. However, Luke does it particularly and importantly as a Eucharist, as an ordinary Eucharist, everyday lived faith experience. So if you do this, if you take the challenge to read Luke from beginning to end, you will likely find up to at least 50 references to food, starting in Luke 1:15 that mentions John the Baptist not tasting wine or strong drink, in contrast to our Lord and Savior, who does drink wine and drink and food with tax collectors and sinners. So look for those 50 references if you so choose. Here we arrive, Luke 24, as Jesus eats some fish with the gathered people back in Jerusalem. Does anybody in our room read Greek? If we were to do that, and no, I don't either, we would notice that Luke also gives some different nuances about the nature of sitting and eating, just an aside for you. Part of my study in the Gospel of Luke led me to that interesting thing, but other than telling you that, I'll just let that go. So, as we come to this scripture, my prayer and hope is that we come to this last piece that we're going to review in Luke from the perspective of meals with fresh and different ears, that we hear it from this where Jesus meets us, how God meets us, that we are starting to put into our minds the distance between us and God, the distance between us and faith, is the distance between us and the table, the distance between us and the table. So this Luke 24 passage, we'll jump back a couple verses. Verse 33 says, that same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem. We're talking about those folks that Jesus met on the road to Emmaus. And there, when they went back to Jerusalem, they found the 11 and their companions. That's what the scripture said. They found the 11 and their companions with Jesus, or they're gathered. Then verse 34 says, they were saying, the Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon. Verse 35 says, then they told what had happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. I told you last week the breaking of the bread is unique also in particular to the Gospel of Luke. Last week, two on the road to Emmaus, Jesus known in the breaking of the bread, And after that happened, Jesus pops out, and the two that were with him after he pops out go to Jerusalem, and they find the 11 disciples and their companions. Who were those companions, you might ask? Have you ever noticed that the 11 had companions? We don't usually read this passage, actually. If you haven't heard this before, that's because traditionally, as we move through the Bible, we skip this piece out of the Gospel of Luke. Many scholars believe the all the rest kind of narrative and their companions is a reference to unspecified disciples that have joined all of these 11 disciples, including males and females. So the understanding in the Gospel of Luke is that Luke is expanding who is welcome in the kingdom, that part of the nature of this gospel, as Jesus is eating with people that the regular religious elite don't eat with, he's also going back and including males and females within this moment. This is one of Jesus, this is Jesus' final moment on earth. So as we arrive at verse 36, we are to understand that Jesus pops from wherever he was, road to Emmaus, right? Back to Jerusalem, comes back to many people, the 11 and their companions. How many people are in the house? We don't know, but it was a lot. Jesus' words as he comes to them are, "Peace be with you. Peace be with you." Your friend shows back up. It's been a hard day. It's been a tough day where you've come to understand him, that he has died. You heard these mumblings around that he has been resurrected. It's still a startling and terrifying kind of story. And so these disciples, as Jesus pops in and says, "Peace be with you," we are told that they are startled, terrified, and that they think they're seeing a ghost, is what the scriptures say. And Jesus counsels them immediately. Why are you frightened? Why do doubts arise in your heart? All the way in chapter 24 of Luke, and still these disciples have troubles and have doubts arise in their hearts. Again, I tell you, it is comforting to me that even as these disciples walk with Jesus, they had doubts and stresses. So for us, if you have ever had doubts of faith and that wrestling, what does it mean? What does it mean for me? How do I really believe this? You are in good company. Jesus teaches them, "Peace be with you. Why are doubts arising in your heart? I'm here with you." It is true, God puts words on our heart. God puts faith in our heart. But faith is not always foolproof. Our lived experience, we know that we come back to things again and again. Sometimes we are able, and maybe you've met some folks who just have faith. That's all there is to it. They don't have any problem. But for many or most of us, there are times in your life, Mother Teresa comes to mind, when doubts and struggles of faith are very real to us. Jesus' word, "Peace be with you." It is so vital for them and for us as we stress and we struggle. It is good counseling to those who were there wrestling. What is this? What does it mean? It is good counsel when we've been through the hardest of things. Peace be with you. And it is the word from our Savior. And I think it is also part of the nature of this turning point that we get to before we move onto the Acts of the Apostles. The end of the Gospel of Luke, if we were reading them together in their original form, would move from the Gospel of Luke to the Acts of the Apostles as one seamless story. So this piece is really a transitional piece. The disciples were still confused, but they seem to be joyful, but they're also still wondering, how is this he and what has happened? In many ways, we should have seen this coming. What happens next is very consistent with the rest of the gospel. We should have seen this coming. Jesus pops in. They're startled and confused. They're troubled. And Jesus says, why are you still troubled? Peace be with you. He shows them his hands and his feet. See, I'm not a ghost. I'm fleshy. They still don't get it. The next thing he does is the next thing he has done over and over again. So do you have any food for me to eat? We should have seen it coming, truly. Now, we also remember that part of the group that's gathered here, he's been calling fishermen, right? He's been calling them. And so naturally, the thing that they have in their stores is boiled fish. It should not be a surprise to us. And he took the fish and he ate it in their presence. Ghosts don't eat. The dead don't eat. Jesus ate with them. And in that moment, everything has been revealed again. Again and again, Jesus comes to us. Fishermen, anglers, has fish to share. And it is Jesus in this moment who initiates this final last meal. Last week with the road to Emmaus, it was those good disciples who said, hey, come over to our house, and initiated that hospitality. And we think to ourselves, that's part of our faith also, initiating hospitality with the stranger, and we might yet find Jesus. But in this final teaching, Jesus initiates this final and last meal for his final instructions to the disciples. Death and resurrection is hard to understand. Crucifixion, resurrection, everything that has happened, the prophecies that have been passed down to us, faith is hard to discern, but a shared meal is not. Sitting together around the table in a final last meal is clarity about that moment, community coming together, family coming together, shared meal together, in that fleshy moment of being human with one another. But it's also a vision of the future. Again and again, Jesus does this, teaching in the moment for the now. How do we relate to one another, but also an image of what is to come? Our understanding of what is to come, it is the heavenly banquet where we'll sit around with the finest thing and have a meal with the whole community. One of my favorite pastors growing up that I just find beloved always says, the final banquet, the heavenly banquet, when we get there, we will be surprised at who all else is there. Jesus is fully inclusive, bringing the tax collectors, the sinners, the women, everybody coming to the final banquet. This is the nature of the Gospel of Luke. This is the nature of how Jesus functions in this passage, in this whole story. Come to the table and experience faith and God and God's call and welcome to all. One final thing I want to share with you because I found it so compelling. I was at the Board of Ordained Ministry meeting this last week, Monday through Thursday, the Board of Ordained Ministry, so many people from Los Angeles, and we were at the Mary and Joseph Retreat Center that is in Torrance, up on a hill in Torrance, Monday through Thursday, every day, doing meetings, except when we were watching the baseball game. During the week, we met with those who feel a call to ministry. When you're called to ministry, when you feel a call or a claim on your life, as the United Methodist Church understands it, you come and share that call with your pastor. Usually your pastor has some knowing of it, and then you start working with your local church and your SPRC, and then you move to the district. And it's really this process that's meant to grow your relationships and support you in learning how to run a church or how to be a leader of a church. But it's also meant to be a process or a journey to be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. How do we serve God, and how does God mean for me to serve in this particular way? And many people, all people, experience different calls, from the call of the baptized believer to serve in the world, and the call of the deacon, the call of the licensed local pastor, the call of the lay certified minister. There are many ways in which we experience and understand our call. But this last week, we were talking with folks who are getting ready to transition from their district to the Board of Ordained Ministry at the conference level. And one of the people that I was blessed to speak to came in, and because self-care and because finding ways to continuously be authentic to your own self is so important in being a pastor, and you need to do things that bring you stress reduction and things like that. We always ask questions about what do you do when you're not, you know, going to seminary or walking through the church or leading the church. And the person who came and was sharing with us talked about his recent taking up and learning how to fish. He's 30-something, and he said, "I've been fishing about 2 years now." And he took up fishing because he had a friend who was fishing and had some fishing poles, and they would go out to the ocean and just cast a line out. And he said it took him 7 months to catch his first fish. Now you understand why I remember this story and was so kind of captivated about it. When was the last time we tried a new hobby and kept working at it 7 months before we actually got something done? And somebody in our group remarked on that. And he said, "Well, that's why it's called fishing and not catching." Fair enough. Okay, it's fishing and not catching. And he said when he caught that first fish after 7 months, he said it was kind of an accident. He didn't catch another fish for another 3 or 4 months. We said, "What did you do then? How'd you start catching more fish?" He said, "I realized I didn't know what I was doing and I needed to go get somebody to help me learn how to fish." And so he went and he got somebody to help him learn. And we asked him more about that. And he said, "Well, what I've learned now, these 2 years later, is that fishing is really about the feeling of getting something on your line and then reeling it in. That fishing is as much a feel and a tactile experience as anything else." And he said, "I haven't caught that many fish, but I'm just going to keep trying." You know, we talk about faith. Jesus tells somebody, you know, "I will make you fishers for men. I will make you fishers for people." And as I listened to him and thought about our conversation that has extended several months here about meals, I think of the importance. Jesus didn't come and just have one meal with us. Jesus came and had many meals with us. And Jesus calls us to have many meals over our lifetime, to explore and to learn and to grow. It's part of the nature of faith. Over and over again, we may not get it right at the beginning, but we just keep trying. And Jesus keeps meeting us where we are. Sometimes we ask for help, sometimes not so much. We just keep trying on our own. But it seems so powerful. This is the nature of our faith. Faith is a feeling, casting your line out and feeling it in your heart again and again. As we come to the end of this sermon series, I pray that you take time to have a shared meal with somebody. If it is your nature to do it with a few other people, great. If it is a nature of to have just a meal with one other person and listen to them and learn from them and share faith with them, or just say a prayer and a pause for grace at the beginning. This is how God works on our hearts. Nothing fancy, friends. Our faith is found around a table. May it be so with you into the future. Amen.
Have come to the lake shore, looking neither for wealthy nor wise ones. You only ask me to follow humbly. Oh Lord, with and while smiling have spoken my name. Now my boat's left on the shoreline behind me. By your side I will seek other seas. You need my hands full of care. Keeps on loving. Oh Lord, with your eyes you have searched me, and while smiling have spoken my name. Now my boat's left on the shoreline behind me. By your side I will seek other seas. Fished other oceans, ever longed for by souls who are waiting. My loving friend, as thus you call me. Oh Lord, with your eyes you have searched me, and while smiling have spoken my name. Now my boat's left on the shoreline behind me. By your side I will seek other seas. Oh Lord, with your eyes you have searched me, and while smiling has spoken my name. Now my boat's on the shoreline behind me. By your side I will seek other seas.
Let us be seated and gather our hearts in prayer.
Circle wide, draw the circle, draw the circle wide. No one stands alone, we'll stand side by side. Draw the circle, draw the circle wide. Draw the circle, draw the circle wide.
So we take a few moments to enter into this time of prayer in the silence of our hearts. Check out this picture. Holy and gracious God, we confess that we are so distracted in this world. We are pulled away from the beauty around us, the love that surrounds us. In our distraction, we just forgive to give thanks to you for all the gifts that we have been blessed with, for our daily food, for our health, for good medical care, for every breath we take, for freedom, for the gifts of your word, your power, your holy, unconditional love. When we pause to take it in, we confess our hearts are burning. We are overwhelmed with gratitude, O God. We are overwhelmed when we consider how you have entrusted so much to us. May we be worthy of that trust, O God. May we be people who are unafraid, undeterred, to live as fully and as richly as you want us to live. Help us, O God, as followers of Jesus Christ, to multiply all that you have given us, to risk spreading your word and perhaps to be misunderstood, to gamble by loving those whom others think are unworthy, to take chances by doing good for those who have not done good to us. Help us, O God, to be faithful, to be filled, to desire to increase your glory and goodness in this world. Make us people who share in both word and deed all that you have blessed us with. We pray, O God, for the church gathered today, both here and around the world, that it may encourage all of its family members, all of the gathered people, to discover and to develop and to use their gifts, to use all that we are, to share grace. We pray for our United Methodist Church, for our jurisdiction. As we prepare to elect new bishops, we pray, O God, their leadership may take us into the future and may be dynamic and powerful and willing to make changes that are necessary, but faithful to you. May you, O God, bring forth servants who are visionary, loving, have a sense of humor and grace, and wholly rely on you. We pray today for those who are poor in body or in spirit, for those who are oppressed and heavy laden, for those who are sick and in despair, we pray. We pray for people in our church community and extended family, especially for Tom and Sue's daughter, Shelley. We pray for her as she has had a hysterectomy this week and is receiving treatment. We pray for the best possible treatment plan and care for her and her whole family. We pray with Beverly for the family of Sandy, who is on hospice. We pray also for Beverly's sister upon the passing of her brother-in-law, Charles. We continue to pray for those who are caregiving, for those who are accompanying other family members through declining health. We pray, O God, bring your healing in every way you can and fortify each one for what they are facing. By your Spirit, O God, land upon our hearts and within our hearts and within the lives of those we've prayed for, and help each one of us walk faithfully in this path of our Christ. As we together gather our voices to pray the historic prayer of our faith given to us by Jesus, as we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. When I was a child, I put a quarter in the Sunday school offering basket most weeks. Sometimes I lost the quarter on the way to Sunday school. But when I didn't lose that quarter, I got to put it in the basket, and I felt like I was making a difference. I sat in a circle with other children, and we passed the basket around, and then our teacher led us in a prayer blessing all our giving, giving thanks for God's love. Sometimes one of the children brought in a whole dollar, but usually it was just change. But change often starts with young people. Change starts with a few small coins and can grow into something that makes a huge impact as time goes by. Today at the United Methodist Church of Vista, we are making a difference in the world by caring for our neighbors and teaching the story of Jesus and having fun with our young persons and celebrating in worship every week. I invite you today, please consider making a financial contribution to support the ministry that we do together. It takes a lot of quarters to keep the lights on and keep looking forward in faith. If you are able, you can use our QR code or send a check or drop a check by the office. We always love to see you. And if you think of it, write on your note. Write a note with your giving and tell us who your Sunday school teacher is, who taught you to give and inspired you in faith and loved you dearly. Thank you for the shared ministry that we do together, and thank you for your support of the United Methodist Church of Vista.
Please join me now in the prayer of dedication that you see printed on the screen. Holy God, as we offer our gifts to you to this day, we pray that our giving, we may be reconnected to the reason why we will follow and the reason why we give. You called us to be disciples who make disciples. All in all knowing we are who we are and why we are following, help us to avoid that which distracts. And please us and bring the road easier, that all bring us to the kingdom of justice, mercy, and compassion. Your desire for us in Christ, we pray, a guiding light. Amen. Thank you.
I noticed the words from that are from 1955, where they were very optimistic and looking forward, and may we be so always. After this worship service, I'm headed over to the North Coast United Methodist Church to preside at their Charge Conference, because we are coming up on Charge Conference season. our charge conference. Our first one will be on November 20th after this service. Receive now the benediction. Go forth in faith and peace and grace, claiming all that God has given you and sharing it in the world. In Christ's name, amen.